So, unconditional surrender, World War II in Europe. Just going into December 1940, and quite an interesting little tactical situation developing here in the Eastern Mediterranean, Middle East. The Turks came into play in November and declared war on Syria. Syria is a sort of collapsed former French colony, and with France now conquered, decided just to capitulate. And the Turks stormed through Syria and decided to put some pressure on Palestine and Transjordan, as you can see there, particularly interested in the Haifa and Jerusalem, because that's got a British, that's British national will there, Haifa, if that falls, and likewise with Jerusalem, and Jerusalem's got a factory in it which cuts British production. The British had to scurry about a little bit, used a convoy from Suez to come over here to Kuwait and back again. But that was just a garrison unit that ended up in Port Said, and then they threw another garrison from Alexandria there over into Jerusalem to try and hold it. And now they've got to try and figure out whether they can get that army over near Tobruk, if I can just get a focus on that for a second, whether they can get this army over here from Tobruk. They could strategic move it out here. They couldn't get it into Haifa because that's in an enemy zone of control, but they could park it next to this unit in Jerusalem on the rail line there. And the reason to do that would be because if these Turkish units manage to move around, which they will manage to do, it's obvious that this one here can drop down and just take Haifa. This one here can drop out and then move around this road and drop in behind that British garrison, and at that point that garrison is he can trace low supply within Jerusalem. I think he can claim to be in a city and therefore be in supply, but the city's only going to be a limited supply source, and therefore only a source of low supply, and that's going to slap a -2 counter on him for combat. So the British need to get something in here to reconnect a supply line back out along the coast. The trouble with it making it that garrison is that then you've got two very, very weak units. Now they will probably hold up while the weather is bad. We've got more, if I can find the weather table, but it's severe weather. I'm not sure I can be bothered to try and, oh, there it is. There we go, just to prove it. There's the weather counters, and we have horrible weather here. So, those garrisons will probably hold up through the severe weather, but the moment the weather changes or we get a break, those garrisons are going to be suffering -2s in combat because they're reduced size units, and theoretically the Turks wouldn't make a mobile attack. They could probably all gang up and make an assault and probably take them out one by one. So the British do need to work out how to get this Tobruk unit, this their main army, this motorised infantry, into play without letting the Italian army that's sitting over there in Benghazi steal into Tobruk and take that fort back. So they've got they are being pressed on two sides here and haven't quite got enough to defend this sort of across Palestine and Egypt and their gains in Libya And it's going to be interesting to see how they form some sort of defense, if indeed they can. They've got there's nothing coming in by way of the cavalry. The Russians aren't in play, and the Americans aren't going to be entering until at least a year after the Russians are in play. So they have got to figure out a way of holding the Turks and Italians jointly off, and they're in some considerable difficulty right now. It's the end of January 1941. Things continue to be quite unpredictable, pleasantly unpredictable. The British have been in some real, real bother here in the Middle East, North Africa, and still are potentially. But you can see the Turks had pushed forward and were really threatening Jerusalem here. They took Haifa. They were threatening Jerusalem. They'd moved round. That Turkish first unit, the one on the far right, had moved right in behind the British unit and then pulled back again. The poor weather was really making the attacks against it ineffective. The British, however, did find a response. How long-term a response it will be, I don't know. They had a surprise attack marker in reserve, and were able to conduct a naval invasion into Beirut with a garrison unit, but it's cutting those three Turkish units out of supply. That rail line through Damascus is now in an enemy zone of control, and the hex next to Beirut, both in enemy zones of control. The camera keeps unfocusing on me. Well, I zoom it in too much and it loses focus. Anyway, so Damascus the hex next to it, this one here and that one there, both supply through both of those is cut, and the Turks now have no way forward because they can't move. You can't move from a zone of control into a zone of control from the same unit. So they're going to have to regroup a little bit, re-establish supply, and work out how they're going to respond. Probably by having to wait for the weather to clear up and then kick the British out of Beirut. But that is, the British have got quite a nice little lock on that area just for the moment, at least until while the weather is poor. And those garrison units will hold on are likely to hold on anyway while the weather is poor against the Turks, and that's allowed them just to ship the Western Desert Force here back into Alexandria to keep an eye on this Italian army. So that's the situation in North Africa and the Middle East. But equally interesting is the fact that at the end of the previous turn, the Germans pulled a political failure chit, and that allowed the Western powers a free Western pro-Western marker on the board. And then this turn, the Germans have pulled a no event, and the British, having their pro-Western marker on the board, didn't supply everything. So they didn't pay for that navy in Beirut to get any sorties back. Instead, they saved some cash so that they could afford a political chit. And they pulled a political success. And that has meant that Yugoslavia up here has joined the war on behalf of the Western Allies. And that's quite interesting, because now there's a Yugoslav army there on the threatening Trieste, threatening Venice, threatening Bologna, you know, threatening to rampage across northern Italy unless the Italians get some forces up there and start garrisoning some of this stuff. And equally, it could, if it wanted to, make some rather suicidal moves, perhaps up towards Vienna if they wanted. So that's going to give the Germans have just been sat there filling up, you know, with plans to invade Russia, you know, just sat there biding their time till the weather calms down and they can go into Russia. Now they've got to think about actually Yugoslavia sitting there threatening to attack into the southern Germany where they, you know, they're not really prepared for it. Equally, you know, the Yugoslavs can attack down into Albania, which is Italian, and take, you know, that factory and sap national will. So this is something of a problem especially for the Italians. There's a new front opened up against the Italians, which they really aren't prepared for, and they're going to have to do some readjustment to, you know, a strategic move will allow them to pull up here and block the worst of this. But they can't move into a zone of control through a strategic move, but they can get into Venice. But Trieste looks like it's gone to me, unless I can figure out a way to get an Italian unit in there, but I don't know if I can. So that's made the British Western allies a lot more comfortable. The fact that, you know, the Turks have been giving them a real headache down here in the Mediterranean, they've just repaid the favour basically by Yugoslavia joining the allies and giving the Italians a real headache. So things are swinging backwards and forwards here, and I was really a bit concerned that the British were going to get squeezed and wiped out. But actually, the way things have gone, it swung back, well, back towards sort of equality, if not in the Allies, certainly nowhere near Allied favour, but something closer to equality. The other thing, as I predicted some time ago, the economic warfare is really starting to put the squeeze on the British. I don't know if you can see this here, by the on-map factory count, and the factory lost marker is up to the 4 spot for the British. And they are just getting mauled in terms of the economic warfare. That marker seems to be rising by a square every turn, and their production is just dropping and dropping and dropping. Luckily, they got this. The only thing that's keeping them afloat is the fact that this Commonwealth trade marker popped in a couple of turns ago, and that count, that's like plus 3 bonus factories. So that is keeping British production at something tolerable, but the Germans are. The U-boats and German economic warfare with the port in Brest and the air force in Stavanger in Norway and a submarines counter that halves the British role every time the Germans play it, it's just killing the Commonwealth in terms of production, and they desperately need all the help they can get. So Yugoslavia coming into play is a major, major and probably unexpected bonus that they couldn't have relied upon at all. It was only some very, very lucky chip drawing on their part that's made that happen. So interesting times. So just picking back up again, we're only in February 42, it's the Axis activation, and things are just, this Yugoslav entry into the war, joining the Allies, has just thrown some really interesting little spanners into the works. You can see up here the Germans have had to reroute a lot of force over onto the border here. You can see an army unit up front there, a couple of infantry units, an air group come over, and they've had to garrison some of those southern German cities, just to Munich there, and just to stay safe. But that group will take the factory and the city at Trieste, drop Italian will, drop Italian production. And then there's Durazzo there, that in Albania, that Yugoslav unit is set to take, unless the Italians can work out how to get a unit in there. And the only way I can see of doing that is with one of these fleets, first fleet there or second fleet there, spending some sorties to move over, perhaps into Sicily, pick up the first army there in Sicily, and then shift off over into the port. The trouble with that plan, of course, is that the British have a carrier group based out of Malta, and under that first army in the port there in French North Africa, there's the first fleet as well. The Mediterranean fleet that can intercept into this sea area 22. So this is risky stuff, risky propositions for the Italians to try and move into Sicily and try and collect an army and then move up there. It's ripe for interception. Or the alternative that the Italians have to think about is that the British let that go, don't spend the sorties on trying to intercept it, but then that only leaves one fleet for the Italians to spend trying to get supply into North Africa for the 11th Army there and the 5th or 8th, I can't quite read the number, but the Italian Army over there in Tobruk. So the British could take a tactical decision to let that that first set of Italian sorties go, let them get into Sicily, maybe even let them reinforce Durazzo, and then really go hell for leather to cut the Italian supply into North Africa. Or they could do it the other way round. They could really do everything to try and stop this reinforcement and, you know, accept the status quo as it is in North Africa. But the Italians have suddenly got three or four fronts to think about here. They've got Northern Italy to think about up there. They've got their Albanian holding to think about. They've got the French North Africans that they declared war on over there, thinking they might get lucky and the French North Africans might not even show up. Well, they did, and now they're causing problems. And they've got a bit of a Mexican standoff over here, retook Tobruk, but they've got the British Western Desert Force in Alexandria to think about. So very, very delicately poised situation for the Italians, and it's just really enjoyable just sitting here mulling through it, trying to work out what the Italians can do and what they can afford to do, because of course they have limited resources as well. Great stuff. So I've just moved into April 41 of Unconditional Surrender, World War II in Europe. And the Yugoslavs have done a good job of tying down the Italians. They've occupied a couple of Italian ports, and those both factory hexes. So that's cost the Italians a lot of production, and that loss of production has prevented the Italians from taking sorties off its navies, and that's made it very hard for them to mobilise anything in North Africa, really. So that's kind of locked the Italians down quite successfully. The Germans have also had to divert troops to try and help the Italians out in conquering Yugoslavia, just at a time when it's thinking about launching an attack into Russia. But that got me thinking about the attack into Russia and really why the Germans are doing it. So the victory conditions for the Germans, for the Axis player, is to knock France out or to knock Russia out, depending on, you know, which way you want to go, but to reduce either French or Russian national will to zero. And having done that, to reach the end of the game without having been conquered themselves. So Germany has knocked out France. So to win, the German player, the Axis player, simply has to not get conquered. Now, so the question is, to what extent does invading Russia help them not get conquered? And there's an event in the game called East Invaded, and when the Germany invades the East, either by going into Lithuania, or Latvia, Estonia, or the Soviet Union itself, Russia itself, the Russians get a lot of benefits. They get 5 ground units, they get for free, they get a free air unit, they get free partisan tokens, they get Lend-Lease kicking in to give them more factories. If they lose factories, they get a Russian winter counter that allows them to make it severe weather in the cold zone, which most of Russia is in. They can do all kinds of nasty things, and just for the Germans invading, they get a big bump in terms of units and cool sort of fun events, chits to play with. And so the Germans have got to make quite a lot of ground across Russia just to stand still in terms of the relative balance of power. It seems to me they've got to take quite a lot off Russia in this attack. They really do have to steamroll quite a lot of Russia. And as you can see, by mid-41, Russia is not some sort of pushover. They have got a defence in depth here. They've got zones of control across along river lines and across Russia that is going to take time. And, you know, as the Germans mobilise here, they're going to get 5 free units and a free air unit to throw down, so they can, you know, they can bolster areas that need extra lines of defence. They can pull back. This is not looking easy to invade into by any stretch of the imagination, despite the fact that these German army units with their support are very strong. And I'm wondering whether the Germans can actually win the game by not invading Russia. I'm wondering whether the best alt-history version for the Germans is actually to not trigger all those extra goodies for the Russians, to not give them those extra units, to not give them those free factories and those Russian winters and those partisans, and not hand all that extra kit to them, and form that just a line of defence and say, come on then, come and take us out. And see if they can defend. And I think that would actually be a really interesting game if they, quite fun if they just could defend, if they could make a far more sensible option than invading Russia. You know, no one's in invading Russia hasn't been easy historically. Napoleon tried it. German Hitler tried it. It doesn't tend to work out well. So perhaps the sensible course of action for the Germans is just to say, nah, we'll just park ourselves here, thanks. And if you want to try and knock us out, then break us down. And I'm just looking at that as an option, wondering how it's going to work. I can see there's this huge gap here, because the Germans have got. Romania as an ally, so I suppose the Russians could come in there, and then they could declare war on hungry, or you know, and try and come through this sort of Eastern European gap and attack up into southern Germany, up through here, much where Yugoslavia are. I suppose they could try that, given that there's a huge, great big gap in the line. But then, you know, there's a lot of new German units that are going to come on over the next 12 to 18 months. I'm sure the Germans could put a screen up across there. And then it's a question of what the Americans are going to bring into play. And to be honest, I haven't pulled the Americans out of the counter trays yet. So I've got no idea what they've even got to bring in. So with that, it could be that I'm just completely mistaken, and that the Germans ought to throw everything they've got into Russia and hope for the best. But part of me wants to think that the game is winnable without doing that. That actually you can take the far more sensible option of not invading Russia at all, which ought to be a sensible option. It is a sensible option militarily, not invading Russia. It ought to be viable in the game, I think. And I might try it. I'm quite tempted.